Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm Pastor Buchholz. I serve as one of the pastors at Emmanuel over in Tempe. It's my pleasure to be with you tonight and to share God's word with you as we continue our midweek Lenten series called Repent, Turn to Jesus. We're going to talk tonight about how we deal with temptation and where we look for strength in the face of temptation. Thank you for the tasty meal tonight. I got to join over in the fellowship hall. And for those of you who weren't there and everybody asked why I'm wearing a Darth Vader accessory tonight, I tore a ligament in my wrist back around Christmas time, and then I had some surgery in February to repair it. And so I finally got I had a green cast for Epiphany, and I had a purple cast for Lent. And this just came off last week, and this is just a splint. So if you're really nice, I'll show you after. We're going to begin tonight with the invocation. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, Almighty three in one, with us now as you're with us always. Grant your blessing that we may grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our opening hymn is hymn 124. Please stand. This is what the Lord Jesus Christ says. I know your deeds. You have a reputation for being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Obey it and repent. Turn to me and be saved. For the fear of the Lord is the key to this treasure. Lord, our God, Heavenly Father, give attention to your servant's prayer and our plea for mercy. Hear the cry that your servants raise in your presence. Grant the supplication of your servants who trust in your Son. Hear from heaven your dwelling place, and when you hear, forgive. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, our Father, remember not our sins. Remember your mercy revealed in your plan to forgive us. Remember your grace revealed in your Son's sacrifice to save us. Remember your peace revealed by the Holy Spirit in the gospel, your power for the salvation of all who believe. Forgive our sins, speak to our hearts, enable us to put aside guilt and shame, and dispel our sorrows with the comfort of your word. Satisfy us with the knowledge that we have everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, the Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. In Jesus, you have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace. Therefore, love the Lord, all his saints. We give thanks to you, O God. We give thanks for the blessing of your eternal grace, for the forgiveness of all our sins, and for your mercy that endures forever. As we hear about your wonderful works, bless us with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Amen. We sing hymn 103. Please be seated. Tonight we read the fourth of our Passion readings taken from the four Gospels. This evening we see Jesus suffering under Pontius Pilate. To avoid ceremonial uncleanness, the Jews did not enter the palace. They wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," the Jews objected. This happened so that the words Jesus had spoken, indicating the kind of death he would die, would be fulfilled. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar and claims to be Christ, a king." Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Is that your idea?" Jesus asked. "Or did others talk to you about me?" "Do you think I'm a Jew?" Pilate replied. "It was your people and your chief priests who handed you over to me. What is it you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You are right in saying that I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" Pilate asked. With this he went out again to the Jews and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him." When Jesus was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate asked him, "Don't you hear how many things they're accusing you of?" But Jesus made no reply, not to a single charge. The chief priests accused him of many things. So again Pilate asked him, "Aren't you going to answer?" But still, Jesus made no reply. And Pilate was amazed. But the chief priests insisted, "He stirs up the people all over Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here." On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he'd been wanting to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see him perform some miracle. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and teachers of the law were standing there vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him. Dressing him in an elegant robe, they sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers of the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence and have found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us, as you can see. He has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and release him." Now, it was the governor's custom at the feast to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew it was out of envy that they had handed Jesus over to him. While Pilate was sitting on the judge's seat, his wife sent him this message, "Don't have anything to do with this innocent man, because I've suffered greatly in a dream today on account of him." But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. This is the gospel of our Lord. We'll continue with our next hymn, hymn 104. God's word that's the basis for our sermon this evening is written in the gospel according to St. Mark chapter 14. Those words are printed in your service folder. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Simon," he said to Peter, "are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." This is the gospel of our Lord. In the name of Jesus. The show Saturday Night Live has been around for decades. Some of you might remember back in the 1980s when they used to do the skits with Church Lady. Ring any bells? Now, I'm not going to do a Church Lady impression for you. But Church Lady had a reason why she suspected that a lot of things happened. Could it be, Satan? Remember that? Now, if you go back a decade before that, back in the 1970s, which was way before my time, I'm just saying, there was a comedian by the name of Flip Wilson, and he used a phrase that I actually heard at the dinner table in the fellowship hall this afternoon. What did he say? The devil made me do it. And you might remember those Warner Brothers cartoons with the little demon perched on one shoulder and the little angel perched on the other trying to tempt Bugs Bunny or Elmer Fudd or one of those to do one or the other thing. Well, back about 2,000 years ago, the Apostle Paul wrote to the Corinthians, he said, "No temptation has seized you except that which is common to man." So it looks like comedians and cartoonists and apostles are in agreement about one very simple thing. Temptation is a part of the human experience, isn't it? And maybe it makes for good comedy, because the reality is it's a lot easier to laugh about temptation than it is to resist temptation. So where do we turn in the face of temptation? Paul said, "No temptation has seized you except that which is common to man." But I wonder if in the 21st century, some of those common temptations that are common to the human experience haven't taken on some pretty incredibly uncommon dimensions. For example, the temptation to gossip, the temptation to damage somebody's reputation, to say mean, nasty things about them and to run them down. That temptation has always been part of the human experience going back to the very beginning of sin, right? But today we have the internet. We have Facebook. We have Snapchat. We have Instagram. We can tweet. We have all kinds of ways that we can run people down. We can damage their reputation. And we can do it in a global forum. Uncommon temptation? Or the commandment that says, "Honor your father and your mother." God set up that commandment to protect his gift of parental authority and other forms of authority on earth. And of course, the temptation to rebel against God and his representatives has always been part of the human experience. But when the commandment says, "Honor your father and your mother," and today it means honor also your stepfather and your stepmother and your other stepmother, and now mom's boyfriend is in the picture too, what is a kid supposed to do? Uncommon temptations. Of course, the temptation to commit sexual sin, to lust, to commit adultery has always been around. Just look at David and Bathsheba. Lots of examples of that back in the Bible, going all the way back to Adam and Eve, our first parents in the Bible, in the Garden of Eden. But aren't we looking at a time of uncommon temptation when any 12-year-old kid with a mobile device and a couple of clicks can access content on the internet that would make David and Bathsheba blush? Uncommon times. So where do we turn in the face of temptation? Well, when temptation comes knocking, why don't we just indulge? Why don't we just gratify every urge, do what feels right, do what we feel like doing, just go with the flow, and who cares if it's a temptation? Well, we know that we can't do that. Because the Bible tells us that temptation gives birth to sin. And sin, when it's fully grown, gives birth to death. You and I know that not only does falling into sin, succumbing to temptation, not only does it dishonor our God who loved us and saved us, but it's a recipe for destruction and damnation. You and I know people personally, in our own personal sphere of experience, we know people who have shipwrecked their faith because they walked down a dark path, they let themselves fall into temptation, and they chose to walk that direction, and they ended up losing their eternal soul. Of course, there are many examples of the same thing in the Bible. Temptation is no laughing matter. It's not something that we can just play around with and treat as something trivial. So where do we turn in the face of temptation? Our midweek Lenten service tonight gives us the answer to that. It tells us, repent, turn to Jesus in the face of temptation. So why turn to Jesus in the face of temptation? Well, number one, Jesus knows a little bit about temptation. You look in the Gospels, and the water from his baptism in the Jordan River was barely dry when Mark the evangelist tells us that Jesus was led by the Spirit out into the wilderness to be tempted. And we know from the Gospels how Satan came to Jesus and he tempted him. He tempted his humanity. He tempted him in some very, very, very serious and subtle ways. His first temptation after Jesus had gone without eating for 40 days and 40 nights, he said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Not only appealing to Jesus' belly, but also calling into question his very existence as the Son of God. Jesus replied, "Man does not live by bread alone." So the devil tried again. The devil took Jesus up to the highest point of the temple, and he showed that he knows a little bit about the Word of God too. And he quoted Scripture. He said, "Throw yourself down, because God says in the Psalms, he will give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. They will bear you up so that you don't dash your foot against a stone." Jesus also responded with Scripture. He said, "You shall not put the Lord your God to the test." And then the devil came with his boldest, most brazen temptation of all. It says that he showed him in an instant all of the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said, "I'll give all of these to you if you just bow down and worship me." The implication was that Jesus would not have to shed his blood to redeem the world and buy it back for God. The devil would just give it to him. Of course, that was not possible. Jesus again responded with Scripture. He said, "It says in Scripture, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." But don't think for a second that those were the only times that the devil came and tempted Jesus. Those temptations continued throughout Jesus' life and throughout Jesus' ministry. And now we come to the Garden of Gethsemane. Tonight we see Jesus wrestling with his Father in prayer. And as Jesus is praying to his Father in heaven, the devil and his temptations are right there with him. Think of the temptations that the devil must have set before the Son of God that night. The temptation to fear what was coming before him. The temptation to be filled with horror and loathing at what he was going to have to suffer. The temptation to want to just drop it all and run away. All of those temptations, the devil came with his subtle lies, trying to get the Son of God to fall into sin. And in the face of that temptation, Jesus wrestled in prayer. He turned to his heavenly Father, and he commended all things into his Father's hands. He said, "Father, Abba, Father, you control all things. If it is your will, let this cup pass from me. Yet not my will, but your will be done." So what was so bad about drinking this cup? Well, what's bad about drinking any cup? It depends what's in the cup, right? What was in the cup that was set before Jesus to drink? It was the cup of sin and the cup of suffering. What was in that cup that was offered to Jesus to drink was the disobedience of Adam and Eve. It was the lies of Abraham. was the adultery of David and Bathsheba. It was Peter's denial. It was Judas' betrayal, Matthew's greed, Paul's murder. All of that sin was in that cup that was set before Jesus to drink. But there was more. Your sins were in that cup too. All the things that you have done to hurt other people, all the things that you've done to rebel against God, all of the sinful thoughts that have occupied your mind and occupied my thoughts, the kinds of things that if somebody were able to take them and project them up on the wall would make us run from this sanctuary in utter shame. If other people could actually see what's in here, the things that God also already sees, all of those things were in the cup that was set before Jesus to drink. Jesus prayed, "Father, not my will, but your will be done." And finally, Jesus' wrestling with temptation was complete. He stood firm in the face of temptation. The devil had to leave him. And Jesus left the Garden of Gethsemane that night, and the next day he climbed the hill called Calvary, and he drank that bitter cup to its dregs. All of your sin, all of the sin that was committed throughout the ages, he took it into himself. And when he took that cup of sin and suffering into himself, he took everything that went along with that sin. Wrath, condemnation, even hellfire. But Jesus, in his love for you and me, drank that cup to the dregs. And that's the heart of the Christian message, isn't it? That on Calvary's cross, Jesus took into himself what rightly belongs to us, so that you and I could receive from him what is only his, namely righteousness and perfection, holiness, obedience, and forgiveness. That was the great exchange that God made when Jesus died for us on the cross, as God made him, as it says in 2 Corinthians, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Why look to Jesus in the face of temptation? Because Jesus knew everything about temptation. The big difference between Jesus and you and me is that he never gave in. He never succumbed to temptation. In the book of Hebrews chapter 4, it says, "We have a high priest who was tempted in every way, yet was without sin." When you're facing temptation, turn to Jesus and look to him for strength. But now, in that Garden of Gethsemane, it wasn't just Jesus who was being tempted. There was another temptation that was going on about a stone's throw away. Jesus had gone into the Garden of Gethsemane with his disciples, and then he took three of his disciples, Peter, James, and John, and he invited them to come with him a little bit deeper into the garden, and he said, "Stay here and keep watch with me." When Jesus came back, he found out that those disciples had done exactly the opposite of what he had told them to do. In the face of the temptation to become drowsy because their eyes were heavy and their hearts were filled with sorrow, they had done exactly the opposite of what Jesus had told them, and they had promptly drifted off to sleep. So Jesus returned to them and he said, "Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." You know, you might think that disciples like Peter, James, and John, with all of the things that they had seen in Jesus' ministry, would be the very best equipped to stand up in the face of temptation, wouldn't you? I mean, think of some of the things that Peter, James, and John had seen. It was Peter, James, and John that Jesus invited to come with him into the bedroom of a little girl who was lying dead on a bed. And Peter, James, and John were there when he said to that little girl, the daughter of Jairus, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." And her body was filled with the breath of life, and she got up and he gave her to his parents, to her parents. Peter, James, and John were there to see that. And Peter, James, and John went with Jesus up on the Mountain of Transfiguration. They were there up on the high mountain where Jesus was transfigured and glorified before them. They saw Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. And they heard that voice from heaven. This is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. They heard it. They saw it. They experienced it. And yet, when it came right down to it, Peter, James, and John were also, just like you and me, weak in the face of temptation. James and John, the depths to which they fell, I don't know if you read this lesson in your service this past Sunday, but you might remember how James and John came to Jesus with a little request. No, in fact, they didn't come to Jesus. They sent their mother to come to Jesus. And they said, and she said, I would like you to have one of my sons sit at your right and on the other on your left in your kingdom, right? They thought that they were better than the other disciples and deserved places of honor. They were still filled with sinful pride. And Peter, who? Peter, yeah. We know about Peter. We know what Peter did. In the courtyard of the high priest, he called down curses upon himself, and he swore with an oath over and over again that he didn't even know this Jesus of Nazareth. Peter, James, and John, strong in the face of temptation, not so much. Why? Because they took their eyes off of Jesus. Jesus said to them, watch and pray. Watch and pray. The writer of the Hebrews says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Watch. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Watch and pray. What happens when we don't watch? How many lives do you think have been lost on the highways of this country because just for a second, somebody took their eyes off of the road and looked down at their cell phone so that they could respond to a text? And just like that, somebody's life came to an end. Watch! How many baseball players standing at home plate with a full count have whiffed and struck out because just for an instant they took their eyes off the ball as it was coming toward the plate? Watch. Keep your eyes open. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. In the face of temptation, some people would say, well, you just need to be strong. You need to look right in here. You need to dig down deep inside of yourself. You need to find the strength to get yourself through. You know, I've tried that. It doesn't work so well. You've tried it too. When we rely upon ourselves and our own strength in the face of temptation, it's a recipe for disaster. Watch. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. And pray. Jesus in the garden wrestled with his Father in prayer. His focus was on his Heavenly Father, asking that God's will be done. You and I are also given this wonderful tool of prayer to remain in constant communication with our Heavenly Father. When you and I don't use that tool to pray, when our thoughts are allowed to drift onto other things, the Peter in us starts to deny. The Judas in us wants to betray. The Matthew in us becomes greedy. The David in us starts to lust. The wicked tongue inside of our mouth starts to gossip. All of these things happen because we're not praying and staying in constant communication with our Father. Watch and pray, lest you fall into temptation. Now here's the beautiful thing, friends, because all of us know that in the face of temptation, you and I, over and over again, with the disciples, not with Jesus, but with the disciples, have choked. We've stumbled. We've fallen. And there, too, is a time for us to look to Jesus, to watch and pray. Because Jesus not only gives us strength in the face of temptation, but most importantly, above all, he gives us forgiveness when we have fallen into temptation. As many times as you and I have stumbled and fallen into sin, God's forgiveness, his mercy, his compassion, his grace are infinitely bigger than our sin. So when you stumble and fall into temptation, look to Jesus and return to him and to his cross for the forgiveness of your sins and rejoice in God's forgiveness and favor. Temptation is not anything to play around with. It's not a trivial thing. serious, and it leads to death. So watch and pray. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus for strength and for forgiveness. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Always on Jesus. Only on Jesus. Amen. Let's continue our worship tonight with hymn 319. We will worship the Lord with our offerings of thanks. Please stand and join me as we pray. Lord Jesus, precious Savior, you were faithful to your Father and to me, even to the point of death. By focusing on your suffering and death for me, graciously grant not only that I view my sins with repentant grieving, but also that I focus on your holy, precious blood that cleanses me from all sin. Holy Spirit, Comforter, through the word I've heard, lead me to love Jesus more by living in obedience to his commandments and by holding on to his teachings. Day after day, continue to draw me to his cross, which is blessed with healing gifts for souls distressed, that I may not only be at peace with God, but also seek to be at peace with all people. I thank you also, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me safe throughout this day. As your child, I implore you to graciously keep me throughout the coming night. Into your hands I commend myself and all those I love. Send your holy angels to be with us, that the wicked foe may have no power over us. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Hymn 590 is our closing hymn. You may be seated. Once again, good evening. Thank you for the privilege of sharing God's word with you tonight. I wish all of you God's blessings this evening, safe travels home, and may the Lord grant you a blessed rest and the privilege of rising again to another day of grace to serve him. Look forward to greeting you at the door. The Lord be with you.